Hi friends, how many of you, when you were a child and reading history, wondered how such a small number of Britishers were able to conquer the entire India and rule for 200 odd years? And you were told these explanations in, you know, your school history, that they were technologically more powerful, they had superior banking and coordination skills, etc., etc. Right? But then those did not hold water for a very long time, because there are many other explanations that could be given for all of these issues. Technology, for example, Indians have always been known to be fast adapters of technology. So how come within a few years this technological advantage, and mind you, in 1757 when Plassey happened, the technological advancement was not that big a gap. So, watch till the end of this video, as I will talk about how the British won their first battle, Plassey, go 100 years back and 100 years into the future, and give you a view which will make you think. So, watch till the end. As I said, technology, that should not be the sole answer. Banking skills, in the rest of my video, I'm going to talk about how it was, in fact, many Indian bankers who supported the East India Company or loaned to the East India Company. Then, of course, the final logic comes in. You see, there were many traitors. Very famously, Mir Jafar is named in history. And in recent times, many Hindu merchants, Marwari merchants, etc., have been, pushed forward by historians. And I'm going to talk about them today. And I'm going to explain their role and tell how they have unjustly, of course, there were circumstances, tried to put the blame on them for the British conquering India, and not talk about a very, very important integral issue about the British conquering, which lies at the cornerstone of all this problem. So let's begin at Plassey. That is the first British conquest in India. Now, what they don't like to highlight is, Plassey did not happen in a vacuum. What happened just before and before after Plassey? 1757 is the first battle, right? Before that, in the 1739 is when Nadir Shah invaded Delhi, the king of Persia. One of the most brutal invasions in the history of mankind. He devastated, humiliated the city of Delhi, the Mughal emperor, and his loots go into hundreds of millions of rupees in those times. I mean, there is no exact valuation what he took, apart from, of course, the peacock throne, the pride of the Mughal empire, and the Kohinoor. And why did he do so? I mean, apart from other reasons like, money, etc., one thing he said to Muzamman Shah, the then Mughal king, that you are not able to control the Hindus, the Sikhs, the Marathas were rising from all corners, and they were dominating. So he wanted to re-establish the supremacy. Okay, I mean, at the end of the day, he let the Mughal king rule. Okay, he wanted to show how it is done. So he humiliated Delhi. But of course, now what happened just around Plassey is, in 1761 is when the third battle of Panipat happened, when Ahmad Shah Abdali came from Afghanistan. Okay, now as you can understand, after the Nadir Shah invasion, the focus of Marathas to defend the country was centered around Delhi and the invasions that were coming from the Iranian-Afghanian side. So that is why the British were able to conquer Bengal without any focus from, the rest of India. This is the background in which Plassey happened. Now let's come to Bengal and the situation there. You see, the traders and merchants of those times were extremely powerful, as there was a lot of trade going on with the rest of the world. One house famously comes to the mind, the house of which was given the title of Jagat Seth or banker to the world. The Jagat Seths like Manikchand and all had good relations with the Muslim Mughal, you can say the people who governed Bengal, and Murshid Kuli Khan, who was became the first Nawab of Bengal when he realized that he can now create a separate state for himself, had great relations with one of the Jagat Seths, who was I think called Manikchand. But by the time around Plassey in 1756, what happened was this young 20 something ruler called Sirajuddola came to power, and not only did he trouble all the Hindu bankers of those times, okay, he was known to be very, very aggressive, violent, temperamental, and he would, you know, not care for the, what you can call, modesty of different houses, if you understand what I'm saying. He is known to have wanted the wives of many of his courtiers, etc., etc. That's what the allegations are. And it made life hell for most people, most of his court. Not only was he anti many of these Hindu bankers and troubling them, he was also troubling a lot of the Shias. So, Mir Jafar, who was a Shia in his court, obviously aligned with some of the Hindu bankers like Mehtab Rai, who was the, that's what the name we get to know probably, was the Jagat Seth of that time, and other Seths like Amin Chand and all, and they obviously wanted to replace. Now, you have to understand, as I mentioned, they was very difficult to get help from the other Hindu kings of that time because there was problems of invasion from the northwest, Afghan, Iran. So they had to turn to whoever was the help that they could get, because it is very easy for us to have think in 250 years down the line and say that, oh, they invited the British. But when you are faced with a young, immature and very, very violent ruler, Sirajuddola, by the way, there are enough and more European accounts also of Sirajuddola. Okay, there's a very famous incident which is very well recorded in UK history, which is called the Black Hole of Calcutta, in which when he captured, the British, you can say factories, etc. in Calcutta, there's supposedly some, in a very small room, some 100 or something Britishers, including women and children, were kept, and many died in the process. Now, while historians can keep debating as to how much of it was true or not, it left a very strong impact in the minds of the British. The British wanted revenge, the merchants were fed up of him, and as I said, Mir Jafar also realized that he had to remove him. Now, the Mughal king earlier at one point, you know, in some circumstances, used to intervene in such scenarios earlier. But with Aurangzeb, okay, what had happened was the Mughal kingdom had got very radicalized. Aurangzeb had set the basis of such, you know, scenarios. And after the Nadir Shah invasion, there was no scope of the Mughal king intervening. So what happened? Well, as I said, the Mir Jafar and the Jagat Seth, etc., sided with the British. The British were able to defeat Sirajuddola. And of course, Mir Jafar came to the throne. Of course, there were further politics, further problem. Again, Mir Jafar was got replaced by the British, and then Mir Qasim came, and of course, even the many of the house of Jagat Seth were also killed, and the British took over. So this is the scenario in which the British took over their first kingdom. But I want to go a little back, 100 years back, as I said, and show you how this all started. Surat. Now we're shifting westward. Surat used to be the biggest commercial hub in India and probably one of the biggest in the world. And for hundreds of years, the big merchants used to be there in Surat. In the 1660s, there was a very famous merchant called Virji Vora, who was probably one of the richest people of those times. Now, earlier, you know, circumstances, Shah Jahan or anybody would intervene if he had some issues. But when Aurangzeb came along, the governor of Surat tried to, as you know, put jizya tax, He tried to convert many Hindu rich people and loot them. The Aurangzeb's armies had also invaded the Maratha lands, looting, ransacking. So, of course, the Marathas also came back in revenge. And the famous sack of Surat happened in 1669. Now, you can't blame the Marathas because their clans had been looted and they had to teach the Mughals a lesson. But in all of this infighting, and you see, in all of these fights, the traders and the merchants of Surat were fed up with all of this. One thing they noticed, and that one thing was that the British factories and some of the other Dutch and French factories, they were left untouched by either the Mughals or the Marathas for a very simple reason. The British defended their factories and they were powerful enough to defend their fortifications. And since the time of Jahangir, the British had been doing business and the other Europeans had been doing business. One thing they had noticed, the merchants had noticed, the Virji Vora and all, and that was that since they were a trading company, they always honored their contracts. The concept which was not there in the Mughal kings. So, post this kind of Surat crisis, slowly and slowly, the merchants of Surat started shifting to Bombay, which had been taken over by the British. This led to them increasingly doing trade with the East India Company financing and the decline of Surat and the rise of Bombay. And this paved the way for the British's increasing power in this country. Now, all said and done, I leave you with this thought that should we not in fact blame the radicalization that happened in them all over the Mughal Empire? Should we not blame Aurangzeb and what he set in motion? Because once he set up in motion the radicalization and the Hindus from Shivaji to the six gurus, all of them rose in revolt. Of course, any merchant would seek stability and would try to get whatever help he can. In the end, I want to leave you with what I said, let's go back 100 years later to 1857. Now, there are enough and more British accounts that I could name on many other Indian accounts written that initially, you know, the Sepoys revolted, many of the Rajas revolted. But what happened? The titular head of the revolution was named as the Mughal Emperor, the old Bahadur Shah Zafar. And while he tried to manage different interest groups, once Delhi was captured, there was a call of jihad from many quarters, which immediately alarmed many Hindus all over India. The reason the Sikhs did not participate in the revolt and many others did not participate, the reason that is not explained to us is that once this seemed like a religious war from each other, and the fight against the British, the slogan was that once we throw out the British, then we will have the Mughal Empire all over India. Immediately many said, look, we did not throw the Mughal Empire for the last so many hundred years to now throw the British out and then get the Mughals back in. That is when one of the major reasons that the revolt of 1857 started losing its steam. So with this, I have tried to cover a span from the 1600s to the 1700s and to the 1800s, showing that one major issue that was very clearly prevalent and very strongly enabled the British to rule was that the divide. And that divide and its reasons must be, I'm sure you all understand. And I would say that while most Mughal emperors can be very strongly attributed with, you know, having some degree of intolerance, most of them, from Babur to, there are many stories of Shah Jahan and all, the final decisive part was Aurangzeb. Probably had Dara Shikoh, his elder brother, been the king of India, probably the level of disunity would not have been this strong. Because once Aurangzeb put in so much pressure, you saw revolts all over the countries. from Sikhs to Jats to Marathas, all over the country you saw the revolts. And whence those revolts happened? Well, sadly, we did rise up, we did throw out the, the Mughals, but had the Battle of Panipat been completely decisive, which it could not be, because, in history textbooks, we are sure that Ahmad Shah Abdali won the Battle of Panipat, but at best, okay, he never came back, so we can say in a way, it was a stalemate. And in that scenario, the British were able to start capturing from the east, west and the south and rule India. I hope I have clarified. I am not the final authority. There should be further debate on this. But I think the debate needs to cover the points that we have raised and not simply look at lame excuses. We need to address that, and historians need to have a more detailed view on these issues. Thank you. Bye.